Assalamu alaikum, you're watching Views and News and I'm Faisal Rahman live from our Islamabad studios. Today we'll be talking about the hearing regarding the Panama Papers case. The five-judge bench headed by the Justice of the Supreme Court of Pakistan, Justice Asif Khosa, was there. The Prime Minister's counsel continued arguments before the Supreme Court of Pakistan. Prime Minister, not dictator or an offshore company, not the director, sorry, rather, of an offshore company. That was said by the Prime Minister's counsel. And then they also presented documents and proof sets regarding the petitioner's job. This was stated by the PM counsel. And again, money trail matter has nothing to do with the Prime Minister. It was stated again by the counsel of the Prime Minister today. The business belongs to Prime Minister's children. This was stated by the counsel once again. And the Prime Minister said his life is an open book. This was stated by the Supreme Court of Pakistan. Prime Minister's lawyers will have to satisfy the court. Again, this was stated by the Supreme Court of Pakistan. The burden of proof is on the Prime Minister regarding the case. This was again stated by the Supreme Court of Pakistan. Another important aspect was that the Supreme Court has adjourned the hearing till the 13th of Jan. Now, where exactly is this case heading? What sort of a situation is prevailing at the moment? Because whenever you hear the counsel of the Pakistan Tehreek-e-Insaf, they express as if they are winning the case. Whereas if you listen to the government side, it seems as if there's nothing wrong. They're perfectly on the right track. But what exactly is happening out there? Where is it heading? To talk about that, we have with us in our studio, on my right, let's start off from Javed, Siddiq sir. So thank you very much, known senior journalist, columnist. Sir, thank you very much for taking out your time. We have with us Khalique sir, again, needs no introduction, known columnist, poet and a philosopher, sir. Thank you very much. And we have with us Liaquat Shehwani sahab, who again needs no introduction, is a senior analyst, sir. Thank you very much. Javed Siddiq sahab, let's start off from you, sir. So far, now the case that has been adjourned till the 13th of January, but whatever has happened today and yesterday, let's start off from there, sir. Your take on that.
I think the Prime Minister's lawyer or advocate has started arguing the case in the Supreme Court. And his argument is that Prime Minister has nothing to do with this Panama leaks or Panama papers or whatever the petition has been filed by the Pakistan Tehreek-e-Insaf. Prime Minister is not involved in any way in this case. So, but the courts have asked questions. For instance, they have asked that Prime Minister in his speech in the National Assembly had said that my life is like an open book, and one of the judges observed that some pages of this book are missing, which is actually the judges are trying to say that something is definitely there which the Prime Minister is not telling the nation or not coming out with. So that's very significant. But today's argument by the former Attorney General and Prime Minister's lawyer was that the Prime Minister has nothing to do with it. Prime Minister is not connected in this case whatsoever. And unless I think the Supreme Court summons the Prime Minister himself to explain these properties, his link with these properties, whether he has a link with these properties or not, it looks that the Prime Minister seems to have nothing to do with it. Prima facie, whatever the documents or the evidence available in the Supreme Court, that's my reading of the situation.
Arisweb, your take on the same point.
Faisal, I think I'm not a legal expert, I mean, to start with. And for me, even if I had been a legal expert, but being a student of politics and history, I think it is more of an issue, it is more of a political and ethical issue for the Prime Minister and also for the incumbent government. And I understand that legally, the onus of proof is not entirely upon the Prime Minister or his family, but if they had been ordinary, normal citizens of Pakistan, things would have been treated differently, or things would have been understood and seen differently. So they have to come out clean. I mean, there is pressure on them, and I you know very well that I have no love lost for PTI. But the thing is that if you look at the political evolution of Pakistan, and I think it is a contribution that opposition, including PTI, has made, that if there are any ethical issues which need to be resolved, and if a person in charge, if the chief executive of the country is even if the claims made against him or her are false, but he has the responsibility to clear his or her position. So I think it is important, and it will bring a lot of change in the consciousness of ordinary Pakistanis. And it has brought a lot of change, not just the Panama Papers, but generally the debate where it has gone, the discourse which has included issues of wrongdoings and corruption.
Correct.
But I would take this forward one bit. And corruption is not just financial. There's a lot of intellectual corruption, where I think some of the opposition political parties are more intellectually corrupt than the incumbent government. So I think it is very important to understand. For example, distorting history. For example, creating a counter narrative in Pakistan. What I call the original Pakistan's narrative is a liberal progressive narrative of Pakistan. So there are political parties which distort history. There are religio-political parties, and there are mainstream political parties which are more intellectually dishonest. They keep going back on their words. They keep apportioning blames, but never find enough evidence to prove that they're right. So they make false statements.
So I
think when we speak about corruption, we should also speak about intellectual corruption and intellectual dishonesty, which sometimes is more harmful for the growth and development of a society than financial corruption. And by no means I'm holding any brief for financial corruption, but I'm just saying that intellectual corruption or intellectual dishonesty is a bigger problem in Pakistan.
I'll just give you an example. This gentleman,
Pakistani powers that be,
the Secretary of Finance, who was caught in this corruption scandal. And honestly speaking, I've never seen that kind of money, even in a bank, the kind of money which was actually discovered from his own house. And if you do a corruption of 40 billion rupees, sir, and you end up giving NAB 2 billion, and 38 billion you can't make even in 10 lifetimes, to be very honest, in Pakistan, no matter how intellectually correct you are, what sort of an entrepreneurship you have in your mind. But having said that, when you see that kind of an attitude of the government, whether it's the provincial government or the federal government, sir, then that raises a lot of questions. And you're absolutely right that intellectual corruption has so many faces, by the way. And this is just one of it. I mean, it's financial corruption linked with intellectual corruption. Because, if I'm a secretary or I'm a bureaucrat, and if I'm, holding a position where I can do corruption.
There's always a ring, Faisal. I mean,
it's never one individual. It cannot
it's
be,
never,
sir.
It cannot be one individual. Even in a small, petty crime, I mean, you need collaborators and you need abettors. Leave alone corruption worth 40 billion rupees.
Absolutely. Shami, sir, let's start from there. Your take, sir, about today's hearing and what happened yesterday.
I would agree with Mr. Harris. It's a more ethical question. If you look at today's remarks of Justice, when he was hinting that Prime Minister has stated that his life is an open book, but few pages are missing. So he raised this question a bit legally, but more ethically. It's an ethical question that Prime Minister of Pakistan, which should be an honest person, and these politicians, they're the people, they go to the masses, they hold huge public gatherings. In those gatherings, people shout for them that I am with you. I'm your,
I support you,
I can sacrifice my life for you. And number of political workers in this country, they have sacrificed their lives for their, for leadership. They have been imprisoned for decades for their, to support their leaders. Today, if you look at the politics of Pakistan, many graves are still ruling over the political parties, over the political workers' mindset. People love them. When these kind of people, they come out in practice when there are scandals. So just look at that, to the minds and hearts of those workers they have been worshipping. these leadership as icons? So this is the main question. So when we talk about ethical question or moral question or intellectual question, look at your society, we are degrading. For a few decades back, people at least had a bit of value, shy in their eyes. If someone would still a cycle in a, you know, mohalla, in a colony, so if people would know that this guy is a thief, so nobody would bargain with him. Nobody had good relationship with them.
Nobody would interact with them. Yes,
he would have been excommunicated from society. So people were shy, and they would go to the, you know, excommunicate. They would migrate somewhere else. But today, look at the people. If you are a powerful person, so as you said, secretary of finance, Balochistan, people are proud.
Talk about the ingredients that make a nation a great nation. Obviously, when you look at, obviously, there is another debate than, you know, that the countries, for example, like UK or USA or India for that matter, one is a bigger democracy, one is the oldest democracy. The point is that they have looted over a period of time. But in our case, they say, well, it's just a 70-year-old country. It doesn't
what
give you
South
the
Africa?
Justification
what about South
to,
Africa?
Be corrupt, 94. To be corrupt.
In 94, look at Nelson Mandela. He was a role model himself. Look at the China. Mao Zedong, his entire life, is an entire history.
So there are so many
look
countries.
Look at Deng Xiaoping.
Look at the way they have changed. They have so transformed totally into...
transformed.
But
the point
is that you need to call a spade. That's where the problem is.
Look, business and politics, these are two different things. If you look at the Western countries, though there are corruption, as Francis Fukuyama in his latest book in 2014, Political Order and Political Decay, he also say incompetency is also part of corruption. If you hold a position and you are incompetent and you can't deliver, so you're corrupt. You are wasting money and time of the people.
You can't produce the desired results.
So look at the chief minister of Balochistan. You can look at the chief minister of KPK. For last three budgets, they have lapsed billions of money. So
in
they,
one of the budget in KPK, I was surprised
to
know that not even 30% of the total amount was consumed. And that's a crime, I
No,
would
but
say.
That relates to the capacity of using money, or you have the expertise to consume and spend that money on developmental projects. And the World Bank has come out with report after report that Pakistan does not have the capacity to spend the money or the funds, development funds, which are allocated to them. And almost 50%, in some cases 60% of the funds are returned or reimbursed. Because they are
and
not
that is
spent.
So tragic, Judge. Yes, yes. Now, coming back to this PM's council, the burden of proof lies with the Prime Minister's council. This was
this is what the Supreme Court had observed in the case when PTI lawyer Mr. Naeem Bukhari was pleading the case for PTI, and the Supreme Court had come out with this observation that the burden of proof lies on the Prime Minister and his family. And today, the
and please, would you like to explain that for a layman, sir?
I
what
mean,
exactly is that supposed to mean? That they
that
are supposed
means
to
that
provide the documents okay, and the
they have
papers.
To prove they have to prove that they are not guilty, that they are not involved, that they have not done anything immoral, illegal, or something that is wrong financially. So no financial corruption has been committed. And that these properties which are in dispute here in before the Supreme Court, they do not belong to this family. And that letter from this this national of Qatar, this gentleman,
the prince,
it has been produced to actually substantiate their case that we have nothing to do with this money. This was the father's money, which was being, you know, invested, which was invested
in Qatar.
So
when you're talking about somebody who is no more alive, and you talk
but,
about the
but
money
that's what
technically
the,
speaking
the Supreme Court has said. And in one of the observations, one of the worthy judges said that this letter from this Qatari citizen is very important, and the entire case of the Prime Minister and his family depends on this letter, because the PTI lawyer was insisting that this page be removed from this entire proceedings, and they said no, this is very important and relevant. Anyway, the Supreme
Initially,
Court
the Council
is going
PTI,
to...
They were saying that this is a piece of trash.
Yeah.
That's
so
what they said.
Let's see what
so
happens.
So how come that paper holds so much of value now, sir?
I think the proceedings are going on, and for the time being, the Prime Minister's lawyer is trying to establish the fact that Prime Minister is not in this picture, that Prime Minister has nothing to do with it. So he wants the Prime Minister to be cleared by the Supreme. Once the Prime Minister is out of it, I think the case will be traveling in a different direction then the Prime Minister's son and his daughter. They have to respond to many questions and queries by the Supreme Court. That case will take turns in the days to come, you know, when the lawyers of Prime Minister's son and Prime Minister's daughter's lawyer will appear before the court, and they will also explain that whatever happened is fair, lawful, neat and clean. If the court insists that the money trail, how the money traveled from Pakistan to Dubai and then Jeddah and to London, or for that matter to any other direction or any other destination, that money trail is to be proven. If the Supreme Court asks these people who are accused in this case,
and they will eventually,
and that's very difficult. I mean, that will give really the case will be then exposed in full view to the public as to what has happened. And this is what PTI is also demanding, and that's the basically the petition is about this, that money trail be established, that they'd be asked to explain the money trail, and that's the most sensitive part of this proceeding.
I was listening to Chaudhry Fawad, who is also one of the lawyers and also the spokesperson in this particular case for PTI. He was giving a very, very funny example actually on television when he was addressing the press conference. He said, well, there is a goat. We can see that it's a goat. People can see it's a goat. The other party can see it's a goat. But how can I prove that it is a goat? So what is that supposed to mean, sir?
Well, Fawad Chaudhry is a wonderful friend, and he has changed three parties in the last
years. Yeah, he was
in
Q-League, and then it was the People's Party, and now he's in PTI.
So I think, you know, and he's an exceptionally good lawyer. So he can prove.
So is his brother Faisal.
He can prove.
The goat as a dog.
yes, I mean he can prove that, you know, a dog is a goat or a goat is a dog. I mean, all good lawyers are capable of doing that.
Apt
and exactly
doing.
That is what Naeem Bukhari said in this, you know, famous clip which has gone viral, where he says that, you know, it's not the lawyer who loses the case. It's actually the petitioner who loses the case, which is quite indicative of you know, what we are going, you know, what we are expecting as the decision. We may be wrong. So Fawad, I think, has said that, you know, because he's a lawyer, but at the same time, he's also the spokesperson of the party.
Correct.
So maybe, you know, I mean, he's pleading his case. He's just, it's a part of the propaganda.
Do you think that they've given up on this case? Because, you know, this is a very pessimistic approach.
I think no political party gives up on any case, and PTI will never give up. Even if they lose, they will continue to actually malign the judiciary. They have done that before. They did that after the nothing was proved in the
rigging,
you know,
case.
The electoral rigging case, and they continue.
They even went after Chaudhry Iftikhar.
What is unverifiable and what is bogus, they continue to mix that up. They'll continue to do the same. It is their right. It is a political party. It is up to their supporters or wannabe supporters or not wannabe supporters to actually decide. I really seriously think is that anything which is sub judice, it shouldn't have been exposed to the media, and both the Treasury, the ruling party, and the opposition should have refrained from holding press conferences on a single day.
Well, the Supreme Court was very categorical,
Supreme Court did not do that
within the premises of
the court. They just said do not do that within the premises of the court. I think it should have been left to analysts and other lawyers and you know, commentators to actually comment on the proceedings, because it does generate a lot of interest among people at large, among Pakistanis citizens, but not the two political parties should have made such statements on a daily basis, which have actually made the atmosphere really bitter from both sides.
Bitter, plus on top, the judges, whether we admit it or we don't, they do come under pressure, sir. Because obviously when somebody is listening to the television or, you know, or word of mouth is traveling, you do understand that this is what this group is thinking, this is what the other group is thinking. So I think when it comes to decision-making process, it becomes a little difficult, for sure.
Well, it does, yes, but judges are made judges because they should be above
that. Being gullible. I agree with you on that, sir. Yeah. Now, sir, another important point.
That is about being beneficiary or being a trustee. Explain that to me, sir.
Well,
what difference does that make?
Well, beneficiary means that you are an owner of a certain property or money or whatsoever. When it comes to trustee, trustee means that you are the one as a trustee. If tomorrow I'm not alive, you're going to distribute those money in my children or anybody.
Is it something like
something
power
like
attorney or something?
Though it's a technical, there is a Pakistan, there are many laws, Trust Act, Agreement Act, Contract Act. So ownership, different things are, I think there are, this is more legal. But as long as I understand, it's a beneficiary is the owner of a property, while trustee is someone, amanatdar, he comes in and, dispense with justice, distribute the property. So this is the difference, which I think.
Now, Javed, a couple of interesting statements. I mean, everybody talks about those. Everybody quotes even those statements. One of Maryam Nawaz with Sana Butcher. Then the Prime Minister's sons were one with Javed Chaudhry and one with Hamid Mir. Then the statement of the Prime Minister in the National Assembly is also on the television. And then other than that, when you look at these statements from a couple of ministers and a couple of senior members of the Pakistan Muslim League Nawaz, they seem pretty contradictory, sir. There seems to be a clash between the narratives, I would say. How do you see that aspect? Isn't that a proof against the government? How do you see it?
The PTI is also...
They're trying to capitalize on that.
Arguing this. They're saying that there is a contradiction and a very glaring contradiction among these statements. The statement of the Prime Minister when he addressed the nation, subsequently when he addressed the National Assembly, and the statements made by his sons and even his wife, Begum Kulsoof Nawaz. All are contradictory, and the PTI has been projecting this, in its public gatherings, public meetings, that look how contradictory these statements are.
Can the Supreme Court question these individuals?
I think this matter has not yet come before the Supreme Court, but they are only insisting.
My point is that obviously, when they talk about whether you have to prove this, whether it's a trustee or a beneficiary. Okay, fine enough. That makes, because that is a very specific point.
Okay.
But when you talk about in general, don't you think that should be a part of the debate?
Yes, it is. But in fact, the major argument of Mr. Naeem Bukhari was that Prime Minister, whatever statement he made on the floor of the National Assembly, is totally different from what they are saying here before the Supreme Court of Pakistan. So there is a contradiction. And I think they are trying to make the case, and they are trying to substantiate that there is something which is being hidden, which is being concealed or camouflaged. Here he is saying something else. Here the lawyer of the Prime Minister is making a different argument.
Can that be exactly cross-question, sir?
But also, in some cases, what I have heard from the legal experts, that the Supreme Court can call the son of the Prime Minister, for instance, and ask that, is this your interview which you had given to a certain TV channel or certain media?
I'll just read out a statement.
Yeah.
Justice Sheikh Azmat Said told Makhdoom Khan that the Panama case is based on contradictions in statements made by the Prime Minister on the floor of the National Assembly after the Panama leaks last year. How do you see the statement, sir?
Yes, it is important. And so therefore, you have to establish that what are those missing links? I mean, when the Supreme Court observed that some of the pages are missing from Prime Minister's book, that's the case. The PTI has to prove to the court that, yes, these are the pages which are missing from these books, and that will substantiate their case.
I'm sure, Khalique sir.
And as far as we know, that in books, the pages, when the pages are missing, so it means they have been used in examination in cheating. So in practice, in
you
advance,
can take the whole book
it has
if
been
you want to cheat.
Happen,
it depends on the examiner also.
But Rakhid remembers his college days.
Okay. We're just having a word before that.
But these missing links are very important.
Really important. Because sir, if you just remove this page, you can't relate page number one with page number three if two is missing. Now, my point is, Harsh, We do understand it's a very important case. It has got a lot of value at the moment. But when you listen to the speech of the Prime Minister on the floor of the House, there was no mention of the Qatari prince or the involvement of his father and the money trail in one way or the other. And I still remember when the Prime Minister presented, well, he very categorically mentioned this was how we got this money and this is exactly what happened during those days. This is how my father invested the money. That's how it got multiplied. Then we invested further and then we went. But the purchase of a certain property, property A, B or C, obviously said it's documented, right? So it's not a joke. And you're talking about not Pakistan, you're talking about UK. Why is it so difficult to establish when that property was purchased, sir? Whether it was 2004 or 6 or 2 or 1996? I mean, what is the rocket science in that, sir?
In whose name it was purchased is the question, not when was it purchased. And going back to the question of proving that the Prime Minister is guilty, he can be reprimanded by the Supreme Court, which is most likely to happen if you ask me, but not removed from his office. Because there is not, you see, legally, he is in a much better position than on ethical grounds. So I think it is more important.
Legal grounds matter most.
Legal grounds matter, but you know, if some information is missing, then you can ask for that information. And the Prime Minister actually had said twice on the television as well as on the floor of the Assembly that, you know, constitute a commission. He's ready to constitute a commission.
And now he's also ready himself before
that the Supreme Court constitutes a commission. Mm-hmm. So I think it's very interesting that, you know, if there are any pages missing, then the Supreme Court is neither it is the Supreme Court's mandate, nor it is
to interrogate.
Its capacity to actually find those pages. So it will have to form a commission. And once you form a commission, then this will take
another 2 years, maybe
another whatever. I mean, another.
But Imran Khan is very, very clear. He says that this is going to be solved within a matter of weeks.
No, I think Imran Khan, what the path he's treading now is problematic, and it will tighten the noose around his neck also. Mm-hmm. Because yesterday or day before, he has asked the court or to invoke articles 62 and 63, and he himself just a few years ago was had opposed in public the presence and in case they are imposed the imposition of articles 62 and 63
but
in the Constitution.
Interestingly, the Supreme Court observed that if we apply 62, 63,
then other than Sirajul Haq
saab, nobody is going to be nobody else will be spared.
Everybody will. How does the Supreme Court know about Sirajul Haq saab anyway? I mean, no offense meant to Sirajul Haq saab, but how would you know about Sirajul Haq also?
So it means there is no exception.
There is no exception, but I think, if you allow me to finish, I think there is no exception, and Mr. Khan himself hasn't lived a saint's life. And is not living a saint's life. Nobody is. So I think it's a very difficult path to tread. And it's not about. And I think the institutions must operate within their limits.
Yes.
But at the same time, I would insist that the Prime Minister ethically has the responsibility to clear his name and his family's name, or take responsibility where it is due. And that is also, possible. I mean, in democracies, it is possible that you take responsibility and you accept that, some of that information might have been misleading because we were not clear.
Or that was confusing.
Or misleading. Mm-hmm. But it does not mean that legally he can be removed, as far as the situation stands today.
All right. Now, Shehwani Saab, another important point. When you talk about the money trail, now, what we have learned, I had no clue about this, but now since this, we are proceeding, I mean, like observing it on almost daily basis. It says that if somebody is dead, is no more there, then technically speaking, if my father bought a property which is on my name now, or maybe I'm a beneficiary, or maybe it's a trust, so I'm a trustee, or whatever it is. So how he got that money is out of question. Debate would start from when I got it. Is that correct, sir? Is this how the court is looking at it?
No. Mainly, court is looking at the speech of Prime Minister in Parliament, in which he was trying to remark something about the money trail when he said that during the nationalization. Their old factories, they were, those were nationalized, and later on the period of General Ziaulak, those were restored. Again, in the regime of Musharraf, they had nothing, they did not have anything, and they were almost broke. So he was just giving this statement. This is money trail. Now, he's saying that the money is coming from Dubai because they confessed the flats are Mayfair flats. We own it. So when you own it, when where the money is coming from? The PTI is saying that money has been laundered from
and they always refer to the statement of Mr. Sakda.
Yeah. So this is the case of money laundering, tax evasion. Money laundering and tax evasion code. This is a money trail. You have to prove your innocence through material documents that this money which has been used in these properties of London Mayor flats, they were not the money of the taxpayers of Pakistan. They were their money of their father or forefather, whatsoever, or Qatari prince, they have gifted them, or they had good skills in business that when they went in Musharraf regime to the Jeddah, they at once, the money had been revealed upon them and they got the money, they started
but
the
they
business.
Never said so the money was gifted to them.
Yeah.
They never said that. So let's talk about two important aspects. Now, one is, since the name of the Prime Minister's daughter, Mariam Nawaz, is also, she says that she doesn't own any property, whether in Pakistan or abroad. She's dependent on the Prime Minister. And today there was this debate going on regarding her husband, that how much tax he has paid or he has not paid. That's a separate chapter. But technically speaking, again today in one of the television channels, they were saying that, you know, they are living a lavish life. But having said that, what is the source of her income? How do you see that aspect, sir?
I think it has to be considered and discussed in length, in detail, in the Supreme Court. This is a technical issue. This is a legal issue. But I think the important, another important aspect of this entire case is that the Prime Minister, the way he has presented himself in the court, and he's so confident while he was making a speech that I am ready to be held accountable. I am ready to go
That's great,
appear before the Supreme Court, or I am ready to appear before a commission if the Supreme Court constitutes that commission. His confidence, made an impression on me that he's very confident that he will be getting a clean chit from the Supreme Court or from the commission. Because had there been something which the Prime Minister had feared could actually be an embarrassment for him legally or ethically or otherwise, he would not have done it. I think the Prime Minister's agreed that he is going to appear before the court, he is going to argue the case, and he is going to come clean out of it. That is my assessment, that Prime Minister will not be, maybe he's reprimanded, as Mr. Harris was saying, or the Supreme Court gives him some warning or something like this. But I think there'll be no big sentence coming out against him.
So talking about the statements, I mean, they're very funny. Even the Supreme Court judges didn't like that. I'm talking about Sheikh Rashid Saab. He said, well, Qatari princes like Rescue 1122. So, and
very
then a couple of other statements he issued. I mean, what I'm saying is that, and he said, he was looking very confident on TV when he was talking to a lot of anchors on the television. And he said that, well, my arguments were very straight and the Supreme Court was very serious in listening to that. And this is what, because there's a way he expresses, so that's pretty funny. But the point is that if we talk about the gist of what he said, he thinks he has made a lot of sense. Earlier, they were pretty confused when the Supreme Court wasn't that happy on the remarks or the arguments made by the
Sheikh Rashid.
No, sir. I'm talking about I've forgotten the name of Bukhari Saab.
Bukhari.
So Naim Bukhari Saab wasn't satisfied, and after that he issued a statement which you just mentioned. And then Sheikh Rashid Saab seems to be somebody who's so confident that, you know, everything is in control. So it seems that this is pretty confusing for me at least, sir.
No, I think Sheikh Rashid Saab, I have never taken him seriously. I mean, I respect him as a popular politician, and his constituents take him seriously. But he is a grotesquely mediocre gift of Rawalpindi to the rest of Pakistan. He makes a lot of funny statements on the television.
Just to be popular.
Television. No, he is popular. I mean, I'm just saying. But he, you know, historically, he has never been proven right. And he has worked with all dispensations, political dispensations. And somehow when he changes, like recently Mr. Nabil Gabol is following in his footsteps, when he changes his political party, he comes out and tells us that the political party that I have left was wrong all along. But I was stuck there.
But as long as he's enjoying
the perks and everything, anybody who's serious about understanding politics in Pakistan
would not take him seriously.
Would not take him, or should not take him seriously, except that his constituency is a very local level. He has done some, provided some good municipal services to his constituents, and also in the areas of education and girls' education, which should be respected. But that's about it. I mean, if you want to make him, turn him into a national politician or a statesman or an international politician,
he is not the
I don't think he should be quoted.
Mm-hmm.
But I think it's not serious if, as Mr. Aris says, but his case is very serious in Supreme Court. Look at it, that's very simple, not as complex as the case of Imran Khan and Sirajul Haq in Panama case. He's talking about money
but
trail.
But the Supreme Court of Pakistan has to take everybody seriously, whether it's Sirajul Haq or it's Sheikh Rashid.
Yes, they're taking, but the case is serious of Sheikh Rashid, and his pleading is very, vibrantly. And he's saying if there is no money trail from the side of Prime Minister, so it means he's not going to.
He was a part of his cabinet.
Innocence.
When Prime Minister did all that.
Exactly.
He has been.
Supposedly.
Yes,
well,
sir.
Well, this is the unfortunate tradition. Look at Faisal Saleh Hayat yesterday. Again, he joined, People's Party. On that time, he was in People's Party. When? With People's Party Patriot, then PML.
Q.
Then Musharraf, and General Musharraf. And people say that. His hands are red with the blood of, Benazir Bhutto. So again, he's coming back, and unfortunately, Asif Zardari is welcomed him back. So this is the
gentleman
you're absolutely right. I hate to cut you in the middle. You're absolutely right, but Faisal Saleh Hayat does not waste our time sitting in our living room every evening
for
2 hours on different television channels.
Popular,
it's also private television channels promoting a lot of mediocrity through promoting
that sells. Like unfortunately, that
sells. And some of my friend told me that one of the private channel has offered Sheikh Rashid
to host a show. Yes,
so this is the popularity. No, but Faisal does not enjoy that offer.
Sheikh Rashid is not,
and he does not live in Rawalpindi also. He just wrote to Islamabad.
But Sheikh Rashid is not intellectually at a very high pedestal, but very popular on the streets of Pakistan. I mean, specifically in Pindi and elsewhere. Hmm. And the language that he uses while talking,
he calls it the Awami language.
It hits the people. I mean, the people like it, and so he actually speaks the language which the common people in Pakistan understand.
It works then.
That's the secret of his popularity. That's why all anchors I have noticed they want him on their talk show.
And whenever he is on TV, sir, one on one.
But the
that program gets the highest ratings, unfortunately.
But unfortunate part is that he has taken something on himself very serious. I mean, arguing the case for himself in the Supreme Court, and such a serious case. I think the Supreme Court should have advised him to engage a lawyer for himself, because he's not articulate and he doesn't have a deep understanding
of
the legal matters.
The court wasn't happy. Everybody started laughing there. And then the Supreme Court had to intervene and tell the people that we know how to make you keep quiet.
Silent.
Don't bring us to that level.
But my view is that, as I know Sheikh Rashid for the last 30 years, three decades, ever since he was a student leader in Rawalpindi, I think his intellectual grooming is very shallow, and so therefore I think he should have engaged a lawyer to articulate and plead his case in the Supreme Court.
But sir, you engage a lawyer only if you know that you have some substance.
No, no, but he's very confident. Otherwise, he's talking that he has a strong case and he's Allah is his greatest lawyer and
This is what he said
and he's going to argue his own
And he
case.
Said that, you know, I know that and all the judges know deep down in their heart.
And by the way, by the way, you know he's a law graduate.
this was the verdict of Sheikh Rashid.
He's a law graduate. But, I mean, when it comes to arguing cases in the Supreme Court at such a higher forum, at an apex court, I think he will be lacking in so many ways. And he may not be able to prove his case.
Because the problem is that those honorable judges, they are not the street people of Rawalpindi of NA 55 or 56. There's nothing wrong with that.
There but you have to substantiate your case. Exactly, you have to argue it and you have to prove that your case has some substance in it and only then he can get a favorable decision or verdict from the court.
Oh, whatever the court decides. Yes. Future of Imran Khan, sir. The future of politics of PTI, is it dependent on this particular case, sir?
I don't think so. I think in Pakistan, we have not come to a stage where political parties and political leadership is actually, voted out or disliked by people who have been supporting them for some time on the basis of their performance or on the basis of taking U-turns. Because we are, evolving, so there's this kind of binary logic that, you know, ardent People's Party supporters, from ardent People's Party and MQM, Altaf Bhai particularly, supporters in Sindh, to ardent PMLN and Imran Khan supporters in the north of Pakistan, I don't think, the PTI supporter will actually switch sides. People sitting on the fence may not, vote for them in the upcoming elections. But PTI supporters will actually start a campaign maligning judiciary if they lose the case. You can take my word for that.
Maligning the judiciary. I mean, initially, Imran Khan sahab was very clear that whatever decision comes out, they'll accept it.
So the leadership will, but supporters will not.
So what is that supposed to mean, Harris?
Well, that is how it works. I mean, that is how it works in political machines.
Put pressure on all those institutions to sort of go for an early election?
If there is an early election, then PMLN will be the will be the beneficiary.
Even if
Mr. Khan and PPP both should understand that an early election will benefit the incumbent government, whether Prime Minister Nawaz Sharif is the next Prime Minister or not.
All right. Now, Shehwani Saab, there's a strategy in the stock market when things are pretty confusing, you're not certain, then you call that strategy wait and see strategy. You just wait and see. When you talk about Pakistan People's Party, do you think they are following that strategy at the moment, sir? Wait and see, that look at the tilt of the court, where it goes, the way they decided, whether it's in favor of PTI or it's in the favor of PML-N.
Well, after election 2013, we are observing that People's Party has adopted this strategy which you are talking about. Look, wait and see. So that's why Zardari came and went back in exile. He launched, Bilawal Bhutto, and he was just looking towards the politics of PTI, and they knew that Imran Khan does not enjoy the career of a political worker. He does not have that kind of capital, intellectual political base. He does not have an enormous experience of practical politics. So they knew that he's going to shout, he's going to taunt, he's going to accuse the Prime Minister of Pakistan, he's going to degrade is that stature in Punjab. So once the PTI is, tired, and also he has maligned enough Prime Minister of Pakistan Nawaz Sharif and his party, there are dance.
Every time they've maligned, they've lost.
They'll enter the arena.
If you look at the history, every time they've said something, they've lost. They couldn't do it. They couldn't prove it.
PTI?
Yeah.
Yes, and in future, I think this the fate going to of the PTI. Imran Khan is not going to prove anything. And look at the Faisal Saleh Ayat. Again, Asif Zardari is hunting.
Concept is obsessed with Faisal Saleh Ayat.
No, look at the strategy. Now he's hunting the winning horses, particular old People's Party, experience, veteran.
Especially in Punjab, sir, when you talk about Punjab.
Targeted southern Punjab, and then he will come to northern Punjab, then I think to the central Punjab. So this is the strategy of Asif Zardari. He has launched Bilawal Bhutto for Punjab, and he will remain, you know, leader of Sindh. So this is a strategy.
So, I think we need to also adopt the same strategy of wait
but
and see.
I think we have to respect. But I think one should give a credit to PTI that they have taken this case, this Panama case, to the Supreme Court, and they have been able to make Prime Minister and his family responsible or accountable before the court of law.
That's so you believe whatever the decision is, it really doesn't make any difference?
I did mention that.
Yeah, that's a contribution. In Pakistan's history, there has been no precedent that the Prime Minister, sitting Prime Minister, is called, except Yusuf Raza Gilani, who was
and Parvez Ashraf.
Parvez Ashraf also, they were from PPP.
And Zade Bhutto, if you...
Zade Bhutto in a different context. But on corruption, on committing corruption or embezzlement, this is the first time that the sitting Prime Minister is explaining his position in the Supreme Court of Pakistan. And if that continues, it will be good for Pakistan. It's a good omen for Pakistan's democracy.
Last quick comment, Haris Saab.
I think it is important what Javed Saab has just said, but I think it is also important that political parties, whichever political parties they are, start respecting other institutions.
I think that is the key, sir.
Well, I think Supreme Court is moving towards a good direction. Speedy trials are there, daily basis hearings are there. So there is an illegal exam, justice is delayed, justice is denied. It does not seem that it would be going to be at least delayed. So Supreme Court as an institution...
I mean, they're doing almost a daily basis. As regard, it's delayed. But the most interesting part is that at the end of the day, I think the institutions that matter the most. The seat of the Prime Minister matters more than the individual himself.
Yes.
So that is the key. And as far as Supreme Court of Pakistan is concerned, sir, I think everybody's looking towards that, and we all expect to come up with a reasonably better decision which the nation can actually digest. That is going to be very important.
But nation will never be a monolith. So they just have to come with a fair decision that they think is fair and just.
And it should be respected.
It should be respected among all. Okay. Javed Saab, thank you very much. Khalique Saab, it was a pleasure. And Shehwani Saab, thank you so much for being here, sir. And that's all we have for this hour. I'll see you at 8 tomorrow. Till then, you take good care of yourself. Khuda hafiz from our side.